put that first reference up, comes from the book of Hebrews. One of the things I've been saying to you as you look at the chronological Bible is that you need to understand things have to be kept in context. That's one reason I like how that Bible is laid out. Context is so important. When I get to Samson, I do not like Samson at all. Growing up as a little kid, we always talked about, well, Samson's a strong man of the Bible. Okay, I bought into that for a while, and then I said, wait a minute, he never rose from the grave. Only my Jesus did that. So, Samson, you got the back seat. You're not the strong guy, and you're not the strongest man in the Bible. Jesus is. And that part of what Joe was talking about as he was praying this morning, trying to share his thoughts and lift his words up to the Lord, was to remind each of us, you know, we all need to prepare. We all have to be prepared. And sometimes in that preparation, it's hard for us to understand some of the things going on in Scripture. The Hebrew passage really, for me, helps to understand a little bit about Samson. Because as you read through the passage, you know, the writer of Hebrews says, look, I don't have time to talk about. Now, this chapter, and why he's saying this, this is chapter 11 of Hebrews. It's called one of the seven greatest chapters in all the Bible, because it's a chapter about people of faith. And a whole list is mentioned there. For instance, here he says, I don't have time to talk about Gideon. He's already been talking about several others. Of course, when you get into Gideon, man, Gideon was one of the great generals of all time. He was not a man that had a lot of confidence, but he did have faith in God. And you get into each of these, but Samson's put right in the middle of this. And it's the next, or the end of the last statement of that passage. Because of their faith, they took over kingdoms, and they ruled fairly. Samson, to me, is arrogant. He's boastful. He is a man that isn't so much about serving. You know, Jesus says, I've come to serve and not to be served. For Samson, so much of what he did was, I'm going to take care of this issue. He was a loner. He'd never asked for anyone's support or help, except on a rare occasion, as you read through the text, starting in chapter 13 of Judges. He was that guy that was always, I will do it myself attitude. He was not a team player. I doubt that anyone could have ever worked with him. He was that type of personality. But so much of what he did was, you did this, and you need to suffer for it, and I'm going to make sure that you suffer for it. And that's what you see all the way through Samson's life. He's not one that's going to hang on the cross and say, Father, forgive them for what they've done. He's the one that's going to say, take them out, God. That's kind of where Samson is as you look at his life. But right here in this one statement, because of their faith, he is put into a category. He is a faith. Now that makes me stop and say, I need to think a little more about what faith is all about. And then it says he ruled fairly. And that's an interesting concept, because we're getting into the concept of justice. Okay, let's go to Judges 13. You want to go? What I've done, I've listed several references from 13. I didn't write all the passages out. You're going to have to spend some time with it. Once again, and that's what Jonathan was referring to when he made the comment, the Israelites had this cycle, this circle they kept going around. Sin, face the consequences, repent, move on, sin again. Doesn't it remind you of yourself? Don't you find yourself sometimes, you come on Sunday and you get here, and all of a sudden you renew yourself, have the Lord's Supper, you sing praises, or you have fellowship, or you study the message together, and you find yourself renewing to face the week. And then sometime during the week, things kind of crowd in on you. And you find yourself, oh, I wish I hadn't done that. I wish I hadn't acted that way. I wish I hadn't said that. Wish I hadn't written that. You know, all those types of things come into play. Well, we kind of go through the same cycle as Israelites. So once again, God is sending a judge. But he sends this judge different. Remember last Sunday I talked a little bit about Deborah. Deborah was a mother sitting under a palm tree. She became that great judge. For Samson, he was not yet born. And God decided, I'm going to send a new birth. He tells Samson's mother, you're going to have a baby boy. I have no idea this woman's name. It's nowhere in Scripture. Manoah, the father of Samson, is identified. The mother is never identified. So when you read through Judges 13, you're going to, all of a sudden, there's going to be some thoughts running through your mind. So he tells this woman, you're going to have a baby boy. Okay. Babies are born all the time. What's the big deal? One of the big deals is there are seven women mentioned in Scripture that God says to them, you're going to have a child. And she is one of the seven, but the only one who is not named. I don't know why. I'm intrigued. Why didn't you tell me a little more about this wonderful lady? Because there's some unique things I'm going to point out in these verses as we go through. It is interesting when you check the historians of the Israelites, those that enjoy writing about Israelite history. There's a list through the ages that have been kept, and they refer to it as a list of 23 upright and righteous women of the Israelite nation. She is one of them, and she's the only one not named. So as you read through, here's this unique woman that we don't know her name, but she falls into a list that for the nation of Israel, she's classified as one of the 23 greatest women in the history of the nation of Israel. And in the Scripture, she's one of seven that God said, you're going to have a child, and that child's going to be something special. And yet I don't know her name. She is told in verse 4, what needs to take place. You must make sure, and she has things, and I'm going to leave a lot of the details for you to have to go back and read. I'm not going to share all the details with you. You need to spend time in personal study. Everybody does. If all you're doing is relying on me a few moments on Sunday morning, it's not enough, folks. You won't let me preach for 6 hours on Sunday morning. Will you? Right? Yeah, that's true. So in the few moments I have, I can't tell you every detail. You need to go back and look at it. But she's given a list of things that she needs to do. And you also find that she is given, that's why I've got make sure and must not. There are things that must take place for her as the mother who's going to bear this child, who is going to judge the Israelite nation, that she needs to do. At the same time, she is told, here's what your son needs to be about. And a list of things are there. He is one of those that falls under what we call the Nazarite vow. So you'll find all the implications there. You'll find the ideas there, the thoughts there. But what happens then, and this is the unique part, the father isn't told anything. What's unique about this woman, the text is very clear. She could not have children. It's very clear. There's no way. She and her husband are not going to have children. God intervenes and says, I'm going to do the miraculous. We're not talking about a virgin birth like Jesus, but we are talking about a birth that God's going to cause to a woman who could not bear children. And the father, you know, when Jesus is born to the Virgin Mary, Joseph is also told some things. In this case, Manoah has to go to God and says, I need some clarification of this. Which is interesting. Because to the mother, to his wife, great details have been given. But to him, none have been given. So His wife comes to me and says, "Hey, I'm going to have a baby." I'm being too simplistic there, but you know, it's kind of like, you know, he comes in from his job, walks in the front door, and she's standing there with a big smile on her face. "Hey, we're going to have a baby." "Oh, I didn't realize that." You know, that's what's going on here. So he wants to pray, and he asks for God to send the messenger back to come tell him what's going on. Verse 12, he wants to know what's happening. Do you realize in all this text, and be sure when you read it, watch how it develops. The angel never tells him what's going on. He does, Manoah does want to offer a sacrifice to God. And when he does, that's why I included verse 20 here. When he does, the sacrifice goes up into a flame. And when it, as a flame goes up, the messenger from God ascends. But he never answered Manoah's questions. I'm intrigued. Here is this wonderful woman in Scripture. For some reason, we're not given her name. She's been living a life that has pleased God. Great difficulty. I'm sure that she, like other women of her time, because she didn't have children, was taking abuse. You know, why aren't you having children? If you follow through the philosophy and the theology that had developed to this period of time, there were those that came to her, much like they did Job of old, and said, "What'd you do wrong not to have children? What sin did you commit? If you'd repent, you'd have children." I'm sure that all that attitude was flowing here. It's never addressed. What it simply said was, "You will have a son. And here's what you must do. And here's what your son must do." I just find that amazing. And Manoah, yeah, you're going to be a part of this. That's the way life works. But Noah, you don't need to know the details. Your wife already knows them. She has to explain everything to you. I threw in chapter 15 here just to bring you to the end of the story, kind of. Samson will lead Israel or be a judge for 20 years. And that was pretty common. You'll find judges that ruled for sometimes 20 years at a time. But where the sad part of Samson comes in is in chapter 16. It's kind of like, okay, the end of the story is he rules for 20 years, and the Holy Spirit chooses not to stop the story there. Scripture's inspired. The Holy Spirit tells us, okay, let me tell you the rest of the story about Samson. He grew up with a mother that kept him focused. He grew up with a mother and father that had faith in God. I'm going to include the father here because keep in mind, he's the one that wanted to offer the sacrifice. He's the one that wanted to pray. So there's indeed a faith in this man's life. So here are two people growing up. Side note for you. So often in 50 plus years of ministry, sometimes parents will say, "I don't know what I did wrong with my kids." Folks, everybody has to make their own decisions. And this is one of those stories. He grows up in a family. He is sent to earth to do something. God has a mission for him, has a purpose for him. And that mission will be carried out. But it could have been carried out much more beautiful if he had chose to keep his focus on God. God's mission has never failed. God's mission is never not completed. God is always successful. And here are two parents that identify a faith in God. And through it, there'll be one occasion, especially in this chapter 16, where he says to his daddy, "I want to do something." And then at one other point, the mother comes in again, and she's not named. The parents come into play here. Samson wants certain things done, and they say, "Don't do it, Samson." Samson ignored his parents all the way through. That will happen in life. But again, it's not that we have to bear responsibility for everything in life. Satan uses guilt to destroy us at times. And you can't let guilt destroy you. It's one of the greatest tools that Satan has against us. So that's a side lesson here. that we could take a whole hour to talk about all that's going on. But you find, in opposition to his parents, that he falls in love. Who was Samson's wife? Delilah. Anybody name their kids Delilah lately? Not one of the names we use much, is it? Not really. She didn't prove to be an asset to Samson. Who we marry, who we associate with, who we build relationships with, sometimes don't prove to be very profitable. In this case, this is one of those examples. Because of it, Samson will fail to carry out, to live the life that God wants him to live. He is to be a judge against the Philistines. The Philistines, anybody know any Philistines living today? No, there's a reason why. Philistines were evil. They were a whole society of corruption, immoral, corrupt. God brought them down. So today you don't hear anything about Philistines. They finally, because of Delilah and her tempting Samson finally yields to temptation. That's why we're taught to flee temptation. We yield to temptations. We fall to temptation. The Philistines will take Samson prisoner. They will poke out his eyes. He will lose his strength. A key passage here is verse 23. They decide to say, our God brought Samson down. Keep in mind the whole story. God raised Samson up. You don't test God. You don't fool with God. God is always caring and loving and compassionate and forgiving. But don't play games with him. He makes a covenant, he keeps it. He makes a promise, he keeps it. He is not someone that goes up and down. He is a constant. That's why Jesus says, I will always be with you. That's who he is. So they begin to worship their God and praise their God for this great bringing down of Samson. Philistines went too far. They were corrupt, they were immoral, they were evil, they were hateful, they were vengeful, they were cruel. I can name all these things for you. But they crossed the line that our God is greater than the Creator. Our God is better than the Creator. Samson finds himself in prison. His eyesight gone, his strength gone. He's pulled out of the prison that he was in, brought before a great banquet, a great time of worshiping a false god, and set before everyone in his state, blind, beaten, defeated. He stands and they laugh at him. They mock him. They belittle him. Our society needs to always be more careful of how we treat one another. It's one of the things that God really despises, how we treat each other, because each of us are created by God. That's one of the great commandments. Love God with all your heart, mind, and soul. And the second's like unto it. Love your neighbor as yourself, because we're all brothers and sisters. But there is evil that decides to corrupt and destroy. This is one of those times. Samson finally says, in the midst of the drunkenness and all this stuff going on, he says, put me between the two great pillars of this temple that we're in. He's standing between the pillars, and he is a massive man. He can reach out and touch each pillar. He says, Lord God, please remember me. And God does. And when he does, one push and the pillar pillars come down, and the Philistines in their reign of terror and hatred and vengeance is brought down. Lord God, please remember me. There you get a glimpse. Here's a man that grew up being taught faith in God, decided not to follow that path as he should, decided to do everything on his own, decided to say to the world, I did it my way and only my way. But at the end, he found his faith, and he said, remember me, and God does. Okay, two quick lessons for you. God's justice. I don't always understand God's justice. Samson was brought into being, put into a beautiful family to serve God. His parents brought him up to serve God. He serves God because God wanted justice done. There were times that he did the miraculous. He took out whole groups of the Philistines at times. But in his death, he took out all the Philistines. Just annihilated that evil culture that had developed. But he didn't become that justice, that judge of justice. Deborah was so unique. She sat under the palm tree and practiced and lived what she taught. Samson doesn't do that. But at the same time, we see the beauty of God. God says, I will not let Samson destroy what I want done. I want justice. There needs to be an end to a culture, an end to a society that does not respect others, that does not love and take care of the widows and the orphans, a society that does not reach out and touch life and make a difference in life. Cruelty will end. Vengeance will end. So what you see here is God's justice is far greater than what we can imagine. And sometimes those that are to carry out God's justice fails to do it personally. But God does not allow his justice to cease. There will be justice. And always will be justice. I just don't always understand. I would not have picked Samson out to be a judge. There's others that I would have seen in Scripture that would have been greater judges. But God used Samson. God can use anyone and everyone. Second, is you need to understand God rewards faith. Samson, you blew it. But yet he's in the chapter, the greatest chapter about faith that's ever been written. And he is identified with people that were beyond measure when it came to faith. And it came down to a man saying, God, remember me. And God does. So often we like to judge people. Jesus on one occasion said, don't be judging each other. It's one of the great sins of all time. We know what it is to have faith, don't we? I grew up in a culture that defined faith not so much about who, but what you did. It's a failure to understand faith. We so often look at someone and says, wow, they don't have faith. Very easy for me to say that as Samson. He didn't. As far as this physical person looking at his story. But yet he is identified as having faith. You see, we're called to serve. That's all we're called to do. Everything else is up to God. We need to correct our thinking at times. And Samson is one of those stories that brings me back where I have to stop and evaluate. How do I look at faith? I am too quick, all of instead of sticking to the business. I'm here to serve, not to be served. So I hope you'll learn something from Samson today. If nothing else, I hope that you learned a beautiful lesson. Samson's mom did not need her name in Scripture to be identified. Samson's mom did not need her name in lights to go down as one of the greatest women that ever walked this earth. Samson's mom did not need a fortune. She didn't need a red carpet. And she didn't need her name on the back of her jersey to be identified. For she was one who said, "Yes, Lord, I will serve." And she did. And just think, you get to meet her one of these days. You might even have the privilege of having the mansion next to her. And think of the stories that you get to hear from a woman whose husband wouldn't even believe her when she said, "I have a message for you." Think about your faith. If you're not right with God, you need to be right. You need to be a person that serves God and lives. "Be lifted high" is the last song. You need to respond.